Hi class, this is probably section one of, I'm going to try to do it all at once, but I'm probably going to end up having to break it in two because I have an appointment I have to run to. So this will be section one of your chapter 11 PowerPoint. Now, as I mentioned in the outline of the last one, go ahead and go onto your Blackboard. You want to click on context and you want to go down. Go ahead and scroll down. You'll note again that there is a chapter 11 here, and this is the basic PowerPoint, but what I've done, I've taken the information from that as well as other information that wasn't available in your text or that I found inaccurate, and I put it in here in chapter 11. I want you to have a good overview of the whole chapter, and you will be tested on this PowerPoint. So please make sure that you watch this PowerPoint, watch the videos, because you're going to need to know that. Do not leave this to the last minute. So, let's exit out of that. Okay, let's go straight to the PowerPoint. Now, what I recommend is that you click on the PowerPoint with me. Go into your content section, click on the PowerPoint slide for Chapter 11, click on that for the 100-point exam, and that way, if you can't see me in this area right here, because my face is there talking to you, at least you can be able to see any words or stuff that are missing. So this is Chapter 11. It's a review for your 100-point exam, and we'll go ahead and start the chapter. Learner, in your book, had four distinguishing points of transition. When do you know that you're ready for transition? Well, when we think about in our life, times in our life when we know that something's about to change, or we're at that point mentally that we're looking for a change, there's four elements, according to Lerner, that kind of happen that distinguish that transition period. For smokers, for example, they'll go on forever and they're smoking, but they realize, you know, I'm not ready to change. Or dieters, you know, I want to go on a diet, but I'm not ready yet. I don't want change. You know, things, I'm happy with the way things are. Or I don't want it, but I kind of do. They're not sure. Well, this basically is, Lerner says that there are four distinct things that happen when you're ready to transition and your mind's ready to transition. And so he talks about those. The first one is relative plasticity. It's always the potential for change. So your mind starts to think, okay, I can see that happening. I can see myself quit smoking or drinking or whatever. Relationism lies in the multiple levels of relationships we have with others, realizing that some of our choices may affect the relationships that are around us. So think of that in terms of relationism, you know, relationships. We make choices sometimes based on what's best for our children. Smoking example again, sometimes people get to the point that, oh wait, I'm smoking around my child. I shouldn't be doing that. That's bad for their health. They're at that point, I need to transition and be a better parent. I need to, you know, do better, make better choices. The third stage that Lerner speaks about for transition is historical embeddedness. No one functions alone. We are independent. We are interdependent, and at times we are linking elements to each other. Basically, what that means, no one person is an island unto themselves. We all of our actions, all of our deeds, everything that we do, all of our accomplishments are linked to other people. We may be, you know, this or that. Like, you might be the best sports player out there, and you can say, "I am the best. I'm awesome." But you got there because people believed in you. You got there because your parents supported you. You got there because they didn't support you and you had a drive to be better and you saw role models and you pushed yourself. So there's a reason historically in your life that links to this transition that you're like, you know, I've got to make this change for me. It could also mean that, for example, for smoking, my grandmother, for example, died of smoking, for example, which she didn't. Historically, I'm scared of that. I don't want lung cancer. She died of lung cancer. So that would be your transition. That would make you push to your transition period. It could also mean that as well. Diversity and individual difference, awareness of how people cope with themselves and their environments. we get to a point in our lives when we can handle stress. Like, think about the first day of class when you're like, oh, I don't know if I can handle all this, or the first a game that you're at and you're like, I don't think I can do this, or I'm nervous, and all these fears are going through your mind, and then you eventually become aware and you learn how to cope with stress, and you learn how to cope with test anxiety as a student, and you transition into a different place. Those are the four things that Lerner said were distinguishing elements that made you ready for transition. So relative plasticity, relationism, historical embeddedness, diversity, and individual difference. Puberty. On average, girls begin puberty at ages between ages 10 to 11. That statistic is a little off. There are children, girls, that are going into puberty in 5 and 6 right now. So that information is a little skewed, and there isn't an exact number right now. They're saying maybe 10 or 11, 9, 10, but on average across the world, it's typically 10 to 11. So we're gonna stay to those statistics right now until we have something new. Girls usually complete puberty by ages 15 through 17. The major landmark of puberty for females is, of course, now menarche, or I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but it's the onset of the menstrual cycle, which occurs between 12 and 13. Boys at age 11 and 12 are usually when they hit puberty, and usually complete puberty between 16 and 17. The major landmark of puberty for males is their first ejaculation, which occurs on average at age 13. Puberty, which starts earlier than usual, is also known as precocious puberty. Puberty which starts later is known as delayed puberty. We're going to focus on delayed puberty because there's a video coming up about that I think you'll find interesting, because most people just think, well, everybody comes into puberty, but there is such a thing as delayed puberty. What changes occur during puberty in women? This is just a basic across the board. Your hormones start to change. Estrogen, for men it's testosterone. Breasts grow, pubic hair grows, your wide hip, you get what your hips widen to prepare you for childbirth. And in men, testosterone, you get your body hair grows, your voice breaks, muscle growth increases. And again, for men, pubic hair grows as well. Does everyone go through puberty the same as everybody else? Well, no. And I want to show you this video that I found very fascinating. I want you guys to go ahead and watch it. And there you go.
It's not always easy talking about puberty. Now, puberty brings body changes. It can feel confusing, even humiliating. What could be worse than that, right? Well, how about never reaching puberty?
My name is Brandon. I'm 26 years old, and I have not hit puberty yet. I have been having facial hair growth, very little arm hair, leg hair, very little penile growth, very little testicle growth, no change in my voice. It affects everything I do from the moment I wake up until I go to bed. I have no dating life at all. I have no sex drive at all. I like women, but I don't really have a drive to go and pursue them. Everyone's different from me. Yeah, I don't feel like I'm at the maturity level I need to be. I don't look like a guy. I don't feel like it physically. I don't like to go out in public. I don't like to be seen. If I apply for a job, they think I'm younger and they don't want to hire me. They think I don't have the experience. I didn't think it was an issue until my early 20s, because you always read online about late bloomers. You think eventually it's going to happen. You don't think that it's never going to happen. I don't have a job right now, so I have no way of getting medical help. At this point, I'm desperate for answers. I need to know what's wrong with me and how to fix it.
Brandon's situation called for a male reproductive specialist, so we sent him to board-certified urologist Dr. Aaron Spitz.
Hi, Brandon.
Hello.
I'm Dr. Aaron Spitz.
Nice to meet you.
I had a chance to look at the chart you filled out for me.
Okay.
And I understand you're here to see me about concerns about your growth and sexual development.
Yes.
Is that correct? Okay, and you have difficulty with getting erections.
Yeah.
And you say that you've never reached a sexual climax.
I've don't really have any desire for sex.
Now, one issue that may be a factor here, just looking at your notes,
okay,
is your potential to be fertile.
Okay.
Is this something that you thought about or that concerns you?
It does concern me. Would you like to have kids if possible?
Well, what I'd like to do is examine you.
Okay.
First, I'm just going to feel your neck, feel your glands here. Go ahead and swallow. I'm going to go ahead and listen to your heart and lungs now. I'm going to take a listen to your lungs. Okay, Brandon. I do agree with your assessment. Your genitals are underdeveloped, and it does appear that you have not completely gone through normal puberty changes.
Yes.
One immediate concern I have is your hormone balance, and it is highly likely that your testosterone is too low.
Okay.
So I'm going to have you get some blood tests that look at your testosterone level, as well as the controlling hormones that stimulate your testicles to grow.
Okay.
I'll follow up with you once the testing is complete, and hopefully be able to provide you with a diagnosis as well as a treatment plan.
That sounds great. Thank you very much.
Okay, guys. Let me X that out. So, thoughts on puberty and puberty stories, especially with this. This is something you don't hear about every day, especially being 27 years old and not hitting puberty. Now, when you think about when males hit puberty, one of the things that happens are that the testicles will drop. Now, the reason why that happens is that the sperm sac has to be away from the heat of the body, or the sperm will not be able to form the amount of sperm that are needed to impregnate the female. So with part of what they were talking about in the video was, because that didn't happen, he's going to have a fertility issue because his sperm count is going to be very low because of that, because the heat of his body is going to kill a lot of the sperm that are available. So that's what he was talking about, you know, his private area. If we were in class, I was going to ask you if you guys had any puberty stories and stuff like that, but you're not, and so we'll just continue on. I need you to know this is going to be on your exam. I want you to be able to discuss the science and the social elements of this video. What was really interesting about the video was they took a medical approach to the problem. Normally, when you think about that, it might be genetic, it's other things. He talked about a lot of different things. I thought was interesting what he said he was going to do in that video. I want you to be able to discuss that in an essay format and summarize the video. And that's going to be one of the essays on your 100-point exam. And anything that you can add to that, personal experiences, your own puberty stories, anything like that, or stories that you've heard, that's all part of that whole summary. So keep that in mind. All right, we'll move on. Hormonal changes in puberty. Menarche, again, I don't know if I'm saying that right, is the onset of menstruation. With men, when we talk about hormonal changes in men during puberty, we're talking about testosterone and androgen in males, and progesterone and estrogen in females. You'll need to know that for your exam. I'm having a problem with the scrolling here. Just give me a second. Okay. Let's talk about Anna Freud. We have talked quite a bit about Dr. Freud and his theories and the id, the ego, and the superego, but I don't know if many of you are aware, he had a daughter named Anna, and she went on with his theories, and she came up with multiple theories herself that she didn't 100% agree with her father, but she worked more on other areas. One of the things that she's well known for is her research on defense mechanisms. That as a teenager, especially in an adolescent stage, teenagers get in this defense mechanism stage where they don't accept accountability. They're rationalizing their own thoughts. They're trying to figure out what's fair, what's not. And she was really focused on defense mechanisms. Now, the video that I have coming up here, and if we don't successfully go through these stages, according to her, we still have these issues when we're older, like isolation, we rationalize, we're in denial. This video covers 11 stages, and I thought it was very well done. And I want you to watch the video on this, please. And then we'll talk more about Anna Freud afterwards.
Today, I'm covering the 11 defense mechanisms and avoidance strategies that are used in our intrapersonal and interpersonal relationships. Welcome back to True Potential TV. My name is Andrea Carella, your relationship consultant and licensed professional counselor. Today, I will be covering the 11 defense mechanisms and avoidance strategies that you may use when you feel threatened, vulnerable, or are facing uncomfortable feelings or situations that cause you some distress. Defense mechanisms are maladaptive coping skills you may use when the amygdala, known as the smoke alarm in your brain, becomes activated and communicates to your body, your central nervous system, that your survival, whether real or imagined, is being threatened. Some examples of defense mechanisms are blaming or attacking others. When your ego is threatened, you may be feeling hurt or vulnerable, may have difficulty addressing your own shortcomings, or don't want to look at your own contributions to the problem. In order to cope with this, you may shift focus and blame and attack the other person instead. Rationalization, subconscious justifications, excuses, and reasoning in order to make a behavior seem logical. Why did he cheat on me? Maybe it's because I'm not affectionate enough or attractive enough. Maybe he just has sexual problems, or maybe sexual addiction or childhood issues. Excuses. Instead of taking responsibility for your actions or lack of actions, you instead come up with all the reasons why it couldn't be done. Or you blame the other person for your behavior. I began drinking because you weren't paying attention to me and you were being distant. Deflection. When you change the subject and focus on someone else or something else instead of talking about yourself. How come you didn't plan ahead and organize your time wisely? Well, I had things to do. I had a long list of things to do. I did the laundry. I cleaned the house. I had my own things that I needed to take care of. Plus, I even asked you yesterday, and you weren't even available. Playing the victim. To avoid dealing with the problem or feeling responsible for the situation, the victim finds it easier to make the other person the bad guy and everything just happening to them. I don't do anything wrong. My wife is just cold and rejecting. I'm just powerless and helpless in this situation. And it can't change. Always going to be like this. Displacement. This defense reduces anxiety and pressure by transferring feelings from one person onto another, otherwise known as dumping on someone. For example, a husband is really mad at his wife, but he starts yelling at the kids. Conversion. Mental conflict that's converted into physical symptoms. For example, if a woman is having problems in her relationship and she starts noticing she's having headaches, stomach problems, chest pressure, but is really just mentally conflicted about the relationship. Regression, giving up your current level of development and going back to a prior level. An example may look something like this. So do you have anything that you're gonna have to say? Are you gonna say anything? Oh, well then fine. I'm just gonna go sleep on the couch tonight. Reaction formation. Overcompensation for fear of the opposite. When there are two conflicting parts in the self, one is strengthened while the other is repressed. For example, someone may be extremely calm and relaxed, but may have a lot of repressed hostility and anger that they are unaware of on a conscious level. Simple denial. Unpleasant facts, events, or feelings are treated as though they don't exist or are not real. For example, a woman waiting till 10 p.m. at night for her husband to come home from work, yet again, and instead of addressing the fact that he could be a workaholic and talking to him about it, she says, "It's really not an issue. I'm completely fine with it. He's providing for us." Fantasy, retreating into a dream's world of times past. Wow, that relationship with Johnny from 2 years ago was really an amazing experience. Wow, look at these pictures of us. We look so happy. Maybe we can get back together. Now I'd love to hear from you. Which defense mechanisms do you use? Please share your comments below because I want to know what you're thinking. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends. And make sure...
Okay. So you learned a little bit about defense mechanisms. And let's scroll down. Back to Anna. She was, again, the daughter of Sigmund Freud. She believed his definition of adolescence was a little too sketchy, suggested that her father had been too involved in the discovery that sexuality begins not at puberty, but in early infancy. She disagreed with that. She believed that sexuality began during adolescence. She saw adolescence as a restoration of the delicate balance between the ego and the id. Anna Freud described two additional adolescent defense mechanisms. One, ascetism, which is sex is sinful, and youth become devoted to a higher level of pleasure beyond physical or spiritual. Now, that PowerPoint I did not have available. I apologize. I didn't see that one, so I'm going to have to pull that one up. Let's quickly pull that one up. It's not one that was in the order.
A purity ring is where you make a commitment to yourself and God that you'll stay pure until you're married.
It's a commitment that I've made and also shows others the life that I've chosen.
My friend and her fiancé have a purity ring set, and it reminds them to stay pure until they're married.
I think that's awesome. I know a lot of people that have promise rings, but the difference is it's marked with words and phrases to help people remember their promise.
What I like about a purity ring is that you can wear it if you're engaged or not. I wear mine because I made a commitment to God and myself.
Me too. I'm wearing mine right now.
Yeah, me too. I'm wearing the princess cut ring.
There are a lot of different styles for guys and girls.
I like to wear my ring on my left hand finger. You can wear it on either arm, just in case if you're worried about somebody thinking you're engaged.
Purity rings and Christian jewelry have become more popular now than ever.
If you'd like to see more, you can visit our friends at TrueBelieversChurch.com.
See?
So, what was that all about? Well, when Anna Freud discovered that asceticism, is basically sexual pleasure is no longer derived from the physical, it is derived from the spiritual for some people. And it doesn't have to be necessarily Christianity. It could also be Buddhism. It could be any form of spirituality at all, that it takes you to a higher level. She recognized that, where Freud did not. He thought it was all focused on sexual desires, but she found that there were people that were able to transcend above their sexual desires and needs for more spiritual purposes. And they also saw sex as sinful or as not as necessary. Intellectualization, the youth feels their emotions or weaknesses in life are logical and should not contain feelings. Let me give you a video example of that so I can help you understand that concept as well.
I was counting on you dying.
You're really bad.
You're as keen an observer as ever.
Sorry about the advertising.
The new season of Elementary premieres tonight.
I like you, Mary. I like you a lot. I want to ask you a question, straight out, flat out, and I want you to give me the honest answer. What do you think the chances are of a guy like you and a girl like me ending up together?
Well, Lloyd, that's difficult to say, and we really don't...
Hit me with it! Just give it to me straight! I came a long way just to see you, Mary. Just, at least you can do is level with me. What are my chances?
Not good.
You mean not good like 1 out of 100?
I'd say more like 1 out of 1,000,000.
So you're telling me there's a chance? Yeah!
So hopefully that helped you understand that concept a little bit better. Basically, it's when we take a situation or emotion or a weakness that hits us and we're logical about it. We try to take what we can out of it, or we don't hear the reality, we just hear what we want to hear to help us process our feelings and emotions. This happens all the time. When you have people in therapy who are stalkers, for example. They feel that the woman told them by their body language that she was interested and that they wanted to be able to follow her. And even though she's got a restraining order against me and she doesn't like me and she says all this, I know deep down that she does because of the way that she looked at me 5 years ago in that classroom when we had that class together. That's intellectualization. It's twisting the feelings and emotions and making it logical for yourself, but not the world around you. And those are two key areas that Anna Freud described as adolescent defense mechanisms. And this goes along with all the other defense mechanism theories that she proposed as well, that we mentioned earlier that the YouTube went over. So you'll have to know this for your, everything on all the slides you'll have to know for your exam. But this, hopefully this example and the other example will give you an idea of what is expected in terms of what the theories were and what the concepts were. We're going to go on to Erik Erikson. Now, we have already gone over Erik Erikson's psychosocial theory earlier in the semester. You know, the infant, the trust versus mistrust, autonomy, shame and doubt. What we're focusing on right now is 13 to 21, identity versus role confusion. So that's where the elements of Erik Erikson come into play. He talks about, within this element, three things when it comes to identity. The reputation of choices, someone who can't keep a job, no loyalty to friends or family, and they cannot be faithful. Their identity crisis, there are situations that cause them to make major decisions about our identity. For example, we wake up one day, we have children, we wake up and she walks out of her bedroom with her hair dyed purple and she's dressed in clothes that normally she wouldn't be normally dressed in. She's trying to figure out who she is. She's in identity crisis mode. Or let's say someone is trying 17 different sports. They're trying to play music. They're trying to do everything. They're trying to figure out what and who they are through their identity. They're hanging around with different cliques of people at school. They're trying to figure out that part of themselves that's uncomfortable, that they're not quite there yet. And when you get there and you figure out, okay, this is who I am, these are the choices that I'm making, you end up at a state of identity, which is the third element that Erikson talks about with identity. And it's the various aspects of your self-image. And they're all in agreement with one another. For example, you could be in identity crisis, trying to figure out how to go to school. What do I do? What degree do I have to? All of us have gone through that. Well, some of us already knew a long time ago, this is what I want to do. They were already in a state of identity. And keep in mind that all these elements, they don't happen simultaneously, and they happen differently for everybody, completely differently. Through our whole life, we're going to go through stages like this. But keep these in mind for Erikson. And again, someone who can't keep their job, no loyalty, that's someone who has a reputation of choices and they're having an issue with the balance between their identity and who they think they are, but their choices are not the same. Someone who thinks, I'm a good guy, but he's cheating on six other people, you're not a good guy. You think you are. Let me explain to you why. You know, society thinks that that's inappropriate, your friends think it's inappropriate. So your choices, your identity choices are all over the map. And that's under Erikson, so keep that in mind. James Marcia is a professor from British Columbia, Canada at Simon Fraser University. I used to live an hour from there when I lived in Washington. And we're going to do a video that he has done. I want to share with you a little bit about him. We're going to start at 5:08 and end at 9:55 to cover his theory. So go ahead and watch that now. And this will cover basically his theories, and you'll be responsible for this. So make sure you're taking notes as you watch this video, and all the videos, actually.
So the least advanced status would be that of identity diffusion, also known as identity confusion. Those classified in this status have not experienced crisis or exploration, nor have they made any commitments. They are identified as having a lack of concern regarding commitments or matters of occupation or ideology, and generally have a low sense of self-regard. As they struggle to respect themselves, they struggle to connect with others. They're often apathetic about their external environment and internal dynamics, and tend to conform and submit to what is expected of them. This can also make them easily manipulated. So these are students that...
Now, as you're going through this, I don't want you to get trapped in the monotone of his voice. I want you to think about where you are as a student. I want you to think about what student are you as he's talking. What stage are you at?
You really want to watch out for in the college environment. Most likely they have not, decided on their own to pursue a college education, but maybe just be following a path that was laid before them or, what was expected of them. And so these students can really get lost, and it would make a big difference to be able to connect with a student in this type of phase and help encourage them to experience new things, explore just the world around them. And so that way they can move closer to making a secure commitment to an identity, which we will talk about can be very beneficial for one's learning experience. The next status is identity foreclosure. Those in this status are committed, but have not experienced identity crisis or exploration. This is a common status for those who are younger in the developmental process. They're functioning without purpose as they haven't explored alternative ideologies or occupations. These individuals show unquestioning allegiance to authority and the same unquestioning submission to rules. Their limited exposure to alternative worldviews also results in inflexible thinking. They maintain conventional relationships without stepping outside their zone of comfort and what is familiar to them. This is a very common status, especially for students who are just arriving on the college campus or in the online classrooms. Really going to be difficult for them to participate in discussions that challenge their already accepted beliefs. And this is something that can be expected, but we can watch for students to progress through this stage as they do realize the many worldviews and perspectives around them. And that typically happens on the college scene.
I want to interrupt here for a minute. We've already experienced that in our classroom, where there's certain elements, and every classroom that you're in, you are continually learning new things that challenge the things that you grew up, like, well, my mom said this, and my dad said this, and I didn't know that about other cultures, and I didn't know that people thought that way here. And as we're learning through our education, it's challenging this stage, the identity foreclosure stage of your life, and you're looking at things, and you're going, huh, you're not quite there yet, but it's working at you. You're starting to look at life completely differently. Your identity's changing because you're trying to figure out what your identity is compared to what you've been told.
The third status is moratorium, and this is a status for those who are experiencing crisis but have not made an identity commitment. They are questioning the values they've likely blindly accepted in the past and are in an overall unstable state. Marsha explains individuals in the status either as sensitive or anxiety-ridden, highly ethical or self-righteous, but also flexible and indecisive. This is a time when individuals balance between characteristics such as accepting, conforming, and obeying, and then other characteristics that are questioning, such as rejecting, rebelling, questioning, or even healthy characteristics, creating, trying out new ideas, values, rules, or overall identities. And it's a status that's easy to spot and where much progress is made quickly, so something you're probably going to see in the college environment. Our final status, identity achievement, is the most advanced status. It's where where individuals have experienced crisis, meaning that they have adequately explored alternative identities. And they've also made a confident and strong commitment to their very own ideological stance and occupational direction. However, this doesn't mean that they're finished developing their identity. With the foundation of their identity secure, these individuals are actually more free to experience the identity crisis exploration. They can investigate alternative worldviews, perspectives, and opinions, and make a confident decision based on their own internal processing rather than just being influenced by their external environment. So it is a really healthy place to be.
Okay, and then that ends that section. Let's see. As discussed, we have the four, identity confusion, foreclosure, moratorium, and achievement. Identity achievement, now keep in mind, James Marcia pointed out that we go through these stages not in order, but individually we still struggle with them. Some people can go their whole life and never have identity achievement, never be able to have their own opinions and thoughts because they're afraid of what other people will think. We all have that to a certain degree, but to be able to form your own opinion, I see a change in the next generation that I've seen coming along in that children are and young adults are being able to voice their opinion more. Their voices are being heard, and I think we're going to have less and less identity achievement, that's just my theory, than we have in the past because of a lot of cultural influences, a lot of historical influences, religious influences. None of those things are bad, but in a school environment, you want to have an open mind to the thoughts and feelings and knowledge of the people around you. So that's important. James Marcia. John Hills falls in this element for factors that can affect your identity. And this is really interesting. John Hills' biopsychosocial theory of adolescent. Biological factors, genital maturity, puberty, and physical growth all affect us. Now, we have already covered this biopsychosocial umbrella before, so it's not a major issue. We know that these elements all interlink. If you remember the circles from the from a past chapter, and originally in this PowerPoint there should have been circles, so I'm not quite sure where they went. The detachment of sense of self, sexuality, intimacy, motivation, identity crisis are all psychological factors, and social factors are the factors that are around us. Race, social class, ethnicity, gender identity, all these things affect us and our identity. So you have the biological factors, and you think about the person from the earlier video who had issues with not hitting puberty. So that's going to affect his identity. You can already saw how painful that was for him not to be able to be, quote unquote, what he felt was a man. He didn't grow, his physical growth wasn't happening, and he was very upset about that. That impacted him more than it would impact anyone, and his identity of who he is. Psychological factors, your level of intimacy, the way you were trained as a child to act around people in public, your identity, your ability to be outspoken, motivation, all factors internally. Your sense of self-confidence in self is the main key factor for psychological factors. Social factors, again, anything in your environment that affects you, anything that you have interaction with in society can affect your identity. Peer pressure, bullying, all that stuff can affect your identity. And this goes through across a continuum from early, middle, to late adulthood. We're going to briefly look at the male sexual system. You're going to be responsible for this picture. This is just basic biology. I'm not going to spend much time on this. Just know that you're responsible for it. The video will cover this. And this is the female sexual system. And these aren't strange, abnormal pictures for you guys, because if you have biology or anything, you're going to have to know the basic systems of the female and male sexual system. This video that we're about to watch, it's got a little thing in the middle of it, so at times it can be hard to read it. I want you to make sure you have a pen and paper ready when you're watching this video and all the videos, because you're going to have to list four systems in both the male and female reproductive system in a summary. And I want you to summarize each system or summarize it all in one paragraph with the four systems included will work as well. But you're going to have to know this video. And this covers it pretty well. It covers both the, I think the full four pages from the chapter, and I thought it was a good summary. And I think it kind of has gives you good visual aid, so it kind of stays in your head. So go ahead and get your pens ready.
Productive system. The reproductive system in males and females is responsible for the production of hormones as well as the process of reproduction. One of the most important organs of the male reproductive system are the testicles or the testes. They are enclosed in a...
Any area that has an arrow and points to it, that's one of the systems, guys, so remember that.
Sac, known as a scrotum. The scrotum helps keep the testicles at a temperature lower than body temperature. This is important since the sperms are produced in the seminiferous tubules located in the testicles. The epididymis is a system of convoluted tubes that connects each testes to the vas deferens. It is responsible for emptying the sperm into the vas deferens. The vas deferens is connected to the seminal vesicle and the prostate gland. The seminal vesicle and the prostate gland release secretions that mix with the sperm in order to form semen. The ejaculatory duct carries the sperm into the urethra, located in the penis. The penis contains erectile tissue and becomes erect during sexual arousal. Cowper's gland, located at the base of the penis, prepares the urethra for ejaculation of semen. The female reproductive system is the counterpart of the male reproductive system. The outer genitals consist of the labia majora and the labia minora. The clitoris, like the penis, is composed of erectile tissue. The vagina meets the outer genitalia at the vulva. Just as males have two testicles, females have two ovaries. The ovaries produce hormones such as estrogen and progesterone. The follicles of the ovaries produce ova or eggs. Every month, one mature egg enters the uterine tubes or the fallopian tubes and travels to the uterus. Every month, the endometrium or the lining of the uterus is nourished with blood and fluid in preparation for receiving a fertilized egg. If the egg is not fertilized, it is discharged from the uterus along with the lining. This monthly discharge is known as menstruation. The uterus is connected to the vagina by the cervix. During sexual intercourse, the semen from the male penis enters the vagina. The sperm cells then travel to the fallopian tube in order to fertilize the egg. However, it is possible only for one sperm cell to penetrate the ovum or the egg and fertilize it. The genetic material from the sperm and the ovum combine and form the first cell of the zygote or the fertilized egg. The egg then travels to the uterus, where it attaches itself to the endometrium. The fertilized egg develops into a human baby over a period of 40 weeks.
So we were more concerned about the fertilization. You can continue watching that on your own if you want to. The PowerPoint's there. You'll be responsible for all the information within this video, and I want you to make sure that you can summarize it. I'm going to go exit out now. Again, four systems in both the female and four systems in the male reproductive system. So that's a total of eight, guys. So you have to have eight systems and kind of summarize them in order to get full points for this question. So remember that. Secular trends in puberty. Let's go ahead and watch that. The reason why I want to pull this one up, we're not going to watch the whole thing. Our textbook says that puberty trends, and what do we mean? First of all, let's go to secular trends. What does secular trends in puberty mean? It basically means that puberty is happening way before it's supposed to, and people are really concerned with that. And our textbook says that it's obesity related, related to obesity and produce hormone production. It's more fat in your diet, the same result. And the presence of hormones like chemicals in milks and meat, it's not really there. It's disputed by the USDA. Well, there's a lot of people and a lot of grassroots organizations fighting back and saying, you're not right. USDA and a lot of other major companies are saying there's nothing wrong with our hormones. There's nothing in the milk. The only thing that's wrong is that we're eating too much fat and we're obese, and that's why we're having issues with, you know, children, girls going into their menstrual cycle earlier. This guy takes it to a literal level, and I'm just kind of want you to see his personal perspective on this.
Four states banning bisphenol A in baby bottles and baby food packaging. It already leaches into the food out of the containers, but when you microwave them in the containers, it gives you massive doses. They also admit that just a little bit of the chemical off of printer receipt ink that's used by more than 40% of major retailers is enough to reduce the fertility of men, increase cancer in men and women. This is bisphenol A. Meanwhile, I have a CNN clip from over the weekend that we posted up on Infowars.com where they've got a doctor on there arguing with another doctor saying there's no evidence it's ever caused a problem, despite the fact there are literally hundreds of studies a year. They are in the thousands overall. Now, CBS News, ABC News, NBC News, they all said it's obesity in girls that is causing this. And they said that's why we need federal controls and basically take people's children from them when they're overweight.
Now, our text is also saying the very same thing.
So they let them sell you corn syrup. They let the companies line things in bisphenol A, put MSG in it, aspartame. All of this causes serious health problems and obesity in all the studies. They know full well it kills the guinea pigs, kills the monkeys with the aspartame, the MSG. They know. And they create the crisis and then come out and say, why are our girls going to puberty at 7? And, of course, in England and the United States, when you bring your girl in, when she's 5, 6, 7, 8 years old going to puberty, they give you hormones to block those hormones, which then screw your daughter up even more. And there's no discussion about the feminized boys. And all of it attacks fertility. But I did find several mainstream news articles that did tell the truth. One was in the Kansas City Starm, KansasCity.com, study finds puberty arriving early in girls. And went on to say many scientists believe chemicals in the environment need to be studied, like bisphenol A, that act like estrogen. Bisphenol A is used in many plastics, food packaging, and even dental sealants. And so they go on to tell the truth and say the scientists and researchers are saying bisphenol A. But I watched all these different newscasts last night and this morning that were aggregated on YouTube. We have them linked up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. And they said, you're eating too much. That's what's making you go into puberty. That has nothing to do with it. And they know that. So they will not tell you what the problem is. And it's despicable. Here's a few minutes of an NBC piece.
Good evening, I'm Ann Curry in for Brian Williams tonight. As a new study published today reveals stunning and alarming findings about the health of our daughters. According to the study of more than 1,200 children, a significant number of girls are now showing signs of puberty as young as 7 years old. With these findings, the researchers are raising concerns that our girls will be at greater risk for behavioral problems, perhaps even breast cancer in the future. In a moment, we'll be talking to a leading pediatrician about what parents can do, but we begin now with NBC's Rahema Ellis.
The results are startling. More than 1,200 girls between the ages of 7 and 8 from New York, Cincinnati, and the San Francisco Bay Area were part of the study. The findings reported in today's Journal of Pediatrics reveal that while the average age of the onset of puberty is 10 or 11, 15% of the girls showed signs of puberty at 7 years old. Among them, 10% of white girls, twice as many as in a 1997 study, but 15% of Hispanic girls and 23% of African American girls.
Early development is a risk.
That's enough.
So we're going to end it there, guys. So that pretty well just gives you a different perspective that the text didn't have. I'll let you make your own judgment calls and do your own research and find your own balance with that. But I just wanted to give you the perspective that not everyone agrees with it's just obesity. There's chemicals, there's all kinds of additives in our foods. There are things in plastics when we heat them up. The old plastic, of course now we have the new plastic that says it doesn't hurt anything if you heat it up or whatever, but what about all the years that we've used that plastic? Those are elements that you need to weigh for yourself and make your own decisions and your own judgment calls. This will end part one. We're going to have part two, and it'll be a lot shorter, but I'm going to end the video now, and I will get back to you guys with part two.